Yeah, well, today I didn't scrub off all the makeup, obviously, because nobody wants to see that. It would be horrifying.
Oh, you're such a girl.
You have no idea. You've never seen me without all my spackle.
Yes, I have. I've had you on video chat, not on the show, without all your spackle.
Oh, well, yeah, and see, it's terrible.
You do not look terrible.
I look like I died 3 days ago. You guys don't understand how much crap is on my face right now. Like, I have so much bronzer just so I'm not blue on camera, because I turn blue, and then I have blush, and then I have the eye makeup, and it's... I got a lot of stuff on my face.
Let's just do the news.
You don't understand these things. You guys have...
No, I don't.
I tell Tom all the time, like, as long as you're clean and you don't smell bad, pretty much nobody complains.
Yeah.
And Tom makes me mad because he has this amazing skin that he doesn't deserve. He doesn't take care of his skin at all. And he has this gorgeous skin. And he doesn't deserve it.
But you're starting to sound like Cecil in Night Vale.
Talking about Carlos?
Yes.
Tom is my Carlos. Tom. He does have a majestic
perfect head of Tom. Hair. Perfect, glorious Tom.
He does have a majestic head of hair.
So shall we do the nonsense?
Let's do the nonsense.
We've got an interesting collection tonight, to be sure. Probably we will start getting the holiday stuff kicked off soon at the end. Each week, Catherine, Radio Dead Air audience, goes out in the worldwide interwebs, finds all sorts of horrible stuff, brings it back here for a little segment we like to call What the Fuck is Wrong with You? But before we get to kicking off the holidays,
I'm crazy for feeling so
lonely. We've got a story from San Antonio. And I understand hunger. I understand food insecurity, as it's called.
I don't like that we've politically corrected that.
Food insecurity.
I think it's okay to say that people don't have enough food and they're hungry. I think food insecure kind of takes away the urgency of that.
It's going to be a syndrome eventually, you watch. They're going to stick syndrome on the end of it somehow. Well, and it's stressful. But
yeah.
This is not, I believe, a way to handle said stress. This comes from San Antonio. A man armed with sword demands free tacos.
Oh.
Adam Kramer charged with aggravated robbery. Adam Kramer, 28, is accused of using a sword in an attempt to get free tacos from a Southeast Bexar County Mexican restaurant. Formal charge of aggravated robbery was filed against him. According to the arrest warrant affidavit, a waitress at the restaurant identified Kramer as the man who walked into the restaurant Monday and ordered 6 tacos, then refused to pay for them. Waitress told sheriff detectives that when Kramer was told he had to pay, he began pulling a sword out of a 6-inch sheath on his waist. The waitress...
That's not a sword. That's a knife.
It's a shoto. It's a
what
short
sword
katana.
Is 6 inches long?
It's a short katana. It's called a shoto.
That's a knife.
Well, there's the katana and there's a shoto.
Yeah. A shoto is like a foot long. 6 inches. That's a knife.
Apparently there was something there to indicate sword.
Yeah, an idiot. That's not a fucking sword. 6 inches is a knife.
The woman said she could hear him outside yelling that if he didn't get his free tacos, someone would die. And I'm reminded of, but I need tacos. I need them or I will explode. That happens to me sometimes.
I mean, a taco at Taco Bell is like 89 cents. It's not going to be as good as a taco you might get somewhere else, but it's going to keep you from dying. I mean, yeah, it's mystery meat and it might have some ground up cat in it. But you know what? Cat has nutritional value.
And hey, Dorito shell bonus.
Ugh, yeah, I never get those. Those gross me out.
I never go to Taco Bell.
Doritos gross me out.
How do Doritos gross you out?
Because they're weird and gross and they're covered in disgusting neon powder that's spicy for some reason. I don't understand the Dorito.
I don't understand this, though. Of all the things, man, if you are going to pull a blade, whatever you may want to call it, sword, knife, whatever, you're going to pull a blade on somebody. Tacos? Really? My ass would be in like the first 5-star restaurant. I want some filet mignon.
If you're going to commit like aggravated larceny, make that shit worth it.
I want 10 steaks. Well fucking done. Right the fuck now.
Well done.
Yes.
Why get steak? Just eat a charcoal briquette.
I don't like diseases. You don't like Doritos with their dust. Well, I don't like blood with their blood.
Well done. Like, what's even the point? You're destroying the meat.
My stomach's going to be destroying the meat in a minute.
Yeah, but, I mean, what's the point of ordering a steak if you're not going to taste it?
Okay, so that sword wasn't good enough for you, huh?
No. Well, there wasn't a sword.
Okay, well, how about a tank then? From Oregon. Oregon man, I love this headline. Oregon man learns driving tank harder than it looks. Sometimes an owner's manual isn't enough. Oregon State Police say that's when a 58-year-old man learned when he tried to drive a 50-ton battle tank up a steep grade near the coastal town of Gold Beach. The Oregonian reports that the 1969 Chieftain had been purchased by a local resident, but a truck driver transporting the tank was unable to climb the grade, so he unloaded it at a turnout. The owner's caretaker, Jeffrey Glossop, decided he could get the tank up the hill. But Hastings says the tank slipped out of gear, rolled back down across the busy highway, crashing through a guardrail. That's bad enough. The next part is what makes this the worst thing ever. Glossop gave it another try, and the tank rolled backward again through another guardrail and down an embankment.
Am I reading this correctly in that this man bought a tank and they let him drive it home?
Well, no, it was on the back of a truck, but apparently they couldn't get the truck up the incline. The grade was too steep. So what the idea was, we'll take the tank off the truck, drive the tank up the incline, and then put it back on the truck. Except, and he decided he could do it. State police note, Glossop had the operator's manual, so obviously he'd be fine.
What he didn't have was Lori Petty. She taught herself how to drive a tank in like 5 minutes. It was a montage.
I think the minute I'm behind the controls of a tank and it slips out of gear, I will learn a terror unlike any other. Those things don't have airbags.
No. I mean, it's not like you're going to die from getting hit in a tank. It's a fucking tank.
No, the tank won't die. You will bounce the fuck around inside and hit metal things with your very soft pink flesh.
Well, yeah.
At high speed.
I'm sure they have seatbelts.
Maybe, or maybe they just go, we lost another one, and hose the inside of the fucker out.
Pretty sure we're not quite that capricious with the lives of our military. We're pretty capricious with our military, but I don't think we're that capricious with the lives of our military.
But it's okay, RMS Gigantic. Hell, I've played World of Tanks. Where's the W key in this thing? Daver asked a great question. How do you insure a tank? I know Flow at Progressive says they insure all kinds of stuff, but I don't think, you know, an Abrams falls under that one.
I don't think the Gecko Geico is going to the Geico Gecko is going to help you with that. There's got to be, I mean, there's got to be companies that do it, though.
What I love is that after the first time of whoops, he was like, let me take a mulligan on that.
No.
No, no, I got it this time. And nobody stopped
him. I mean, he was in a tank. Who was going to stop him? Let's be honest. Are you going to stop the guy in the fucking tank?
Probably not.
Probably not.
So let's go to it. Let's go to a very deadly kind of weapon to a not so deadly kind. Are you going anywhere for the for Christmas, or are you staying in local New Yorkish area for?
Yeah, mostly local. I'll be at my sister. She's about 40 minutes away.
I'm flying. I am flying to England.
No, you're going all overseas and shit.
Which means I'm going to
Which means you need to learn that over there, they do not say Merry Christmas. They say Happy Christmas.
I say Happy Holidays, so I'm covered.
Well, yes, but if you want to say Merry Christmas, you say Happy Christmas, because that's what they say there. So you should practice that.
But, well, my primary concern is actually the customs, because I'm going to have to go through... How bad were your Ireland customs?
Not bad. I mean, you can't bring perishables, obviously, you know, like... But with over there, like, it's not like they don't have any, like, ecosystem-destroying wildlife that you're going to be carrying back and forth. So it's not...
Cows.
So it's not... I mean, they, obviously, you're not transporting livestock, but...
You never know.
It's not that intense, really.
Well, the other end of it, of course, is our friends, the TSA. And we keep getting stories that make us so glad they're there protecting us and looking out for us, because just the other day they protected us from a toy monkey. NSA, not NSA, that's a different problem. TSA agent confiscates sock monkey's toy pistol. Rooster Monkburn, the cowboy sock monkey, is without his pistol, thanks to a diligent TSA agent in St. Louis. Phyllis May of Redmond says she is appalled and shocked and embarrassed all at the same time about the incident that happened on December 3rd. May has a small business selling unique sock monkey dolls. She says she and her husband were on her way from St. Louis to SeaTac, and she had a couple of monkeys and sewing supplies in her carry-on bag. His pistol was in there. May and her husband were going through the screening process when she noticed one of her bags were missing, and the TSA agent held it up and said, "Whose is this?" She said, "I realized, oh God, this is my bag." TSA agent went through the bag, through the sewing supplies, and found the 2-inch-long pistol. She said, quote, "This is a gun." I said, "No, it's not a gun. It's a prop for my monkey." I love that sentence. That's one of the best sentences in the history of the English language. She said, quote, "If I held it up to your neck, you wouldn't know if it was real or not." And I said, "Really?" And I'm going to show you this gun, this alleged weapon, this dangerous item. Here it is.
Yeah, because they have a picture for scale. It's like the size of 3 coins.
That's the deadly weapon. That's like,
even if that was able to fire projectiles, you wouldn't really do any harm with that.
This is a person who is in charge, ostensibly, of protecting us from threats.
But this is the shit I keep talking about. It's useless overreaction. We overact in ways that are not actually helping.
The woman,
the illusion of safety. Like, we have to take off our shoes and we can't have bottled water and blah, blah, blah. And that's not actually making us any safer. But because it's annoying, we feel safer somehow.
There are two possibilities here. Either one, that woman believed that for her job's sake, if it looked like a gun, to keep her job, she had to confiscate it, no matter what.
And I think that's the more likely.
Or, number two, which is just as likely, this woman was a fucking moron.
I don't think anybody's that stupid.
And how do you do this show and say, I don't think
it. But if I had to guess, I would say it's a situation of, well, if I don't do this, God knows, you know? And,
we just had a story about a guy who crashed the tank twice in a row. Yes. I couldn't believe in that level of stupid. This is, if someone pushed this against my neck, I wouldn't know if it was a real gun. Yes, you would. I hope you would. Because if you don't, we're all in danger.
But I mean, I feel like this is a situation of, look, I'm just going by the letter of the law. I'm just doing my stupid job, you know, like.
I hope, I pray, because if not, oh God. Imagine the shit they did let in because it didn't look like a gun.
I need to know from the chat what a terror shot is.
I don't know. I don't know.
They're posting terror shot.
We have and
obviously that's something from the drinking game, but I want to know what it is.
We have rampant alcoholics at this point. They have any excuse to take a shot, they'll take it.
All you people need to be in meetings.
Okay, for a completely...
And this doesn't count as a meeting.
For a change of pace, do you know those... All right, you ever been on a diet and you gotten that little fucking cow you put in your fridge? You know about... Okay, it's a little cow and little plastic toy cow type thing. You put it in the fridge and every time you open the door and the light comes on, it goes... Murr. It's supposed to encourage you by negative reinforcement that it's supposed to shame you into not opening the door to your fridge. You never saw one of those?
No, that's the dumbest shit I've ever heard.
Yeah, but it's, well, no, actually, that was not the dumbest shit you've ever heard. I'm about to show you the dumbest shit you've ever heard.
There's delicious food in the cabinet, too.
I'm about to show you the dumbest shit you've ever heard. I promise you. Microsoft thinks they have a solution to help women-only diet.
Oh, I saw this.
Microsoft.
I think you could argue that it's not women-only.
This is true.
Because, you know, moves.
Microsoft to working on a smart bra to measure mood. Microsoft researchers have designed a smart bra that can detect stress. Prototype contains removable sensors that monitor heart and skin activity, provide an indication of mood levels. The aim is to find if wearable technology can prevent stress-related overeating. Mood data was provided to the wearer via a smartphone app in order to highlight when emotional eating was likely to occur. So you have your bra nagging you not to eat.
I'm going to tell you something that you don't know because you're a dude.
Okay.
Bras are fucking annoying.
And now
they're annoying enough. They're not comfortable. They're not like when I say the first awesome moment of my day is when I take off my work clothes. I really mean the 5 seconds right after you take off the bra, because those things are not comfortable. They're fucking annoying. There's like always some part of it digging into you somewhere. We don't need a way to make bras more annoying.
But now they're calling your phone and going, hey, Piggy, you gonna eat?
I don't need my tits to call me and tell me I'm fat. I've put on 40 pounds in the last year. I'm aware that I've gotten a little bit chubby. I don't need my tits to tell me that.
God. No, but even better, apparently, if you go down to the bottom, they list other bra technologies. Last month saw the release of a Twitter-connected bra that tweeted every time it was unhooked to encourage women to self-examine their breasts.
What?
Apparently, the idea was you take off the bra and it would tweet, hey, you got your bra off. You might as well check it out for lumps. But what this actually ended up doing was becoming a form of slut shaming. Because every time you took your bra off, Twitter told the world. Yeah.
I know, predictable. This kind of reminds me of a funny story.
Here we go.
I mentioned this before. Before my mother passed away recently.
Reverend Mal, the mood bra, calm your tits.
And before, you know, when she was just going through her arrangements with my sister, she was saying she had her burial outfit picked out, but she needed my sister to make sure she had all the proper undergarments. And my sister's like, Mom, I don't really think you need that. And my mother, who was a very proper lady all her days, said, I am not entering the afterlife indecent. I am not going into heaven indecent without my proper undergarments. And my sister was like, Mom, pretty much the second I come home, I take off my bra. So when you see me in the afterlife, I'm probably going to be indecent. Like, and I'm probably going to be wearing a thong. Because my mom was never a fan of the thong. She found them very appalling. My sister was like, so when you run into me in the great hereafter, I apologize in advance for the fact that I will probably be indecent because I will not have a bra and I will be wearing a thong.
And that's why it's heaven.
And Twitter will tell you.
Meanwhile,
if there's a heaven, it should be a place you don't have to wear a fucking bra. Otherwise, it's not heaven.
There's another one in response to a series of rapes in India. Three engineering students developed a bra loaded with sensors and an electronic circuit that is activated when someone attempts to grope a woman wearing it.
What if you want them to?
It's a boob alarm. You have to. Is it like you? Hold on. Before we do anything. Boop, boop. Okay, now proceed.
They have the anti-rape device that you're supposed to wear inside your vagina that's barbed. Have you seen those? That, like, if a penis enters you, the barbs dig into it and you have to have it surgically removed. Yeah, this is a thing. And on the one hand, you're like, well, that's kind of a really great idea. But on the other hand, it's like, you know what? Maybe we should focus on teaching men not to rape women instead of us strapping ourselves down with devices. Like, maybe we're focusing on the wrong side of the problem.
And also, God help you if you forget to leave that in one night. If you leave it in and husband's a little frisky and...
I'm here to tell you, you're aware when something
is true.
Your vagina.
That's true.
You're aware. Not like you're concerned it's going to fall out, but you're aware that there's something rammed up your vagina. You know.
We're learning all sorts of things tonight.
But that's my problem with these things. Like, on the one hand, it's kind of a necessary evil, I suppose. On the other, it's not really the solution the problem needs. It's a solution, but it's not the right solution.
Speaking of not the right solutions. So, you know about the big to-do lately with the fast food restaurants and with Walmart and everything about the workers pushing for a higher minimum wage?
Yeah.
Well, McDonald's put out a little guide on their website to help.
Did they fuck up again?
Yes, they fucked up again. They were giving their workers helpful hints on what to pay people who worked for you during the holidays. Like personal trainers and au pairs and dog walkers.
And all the sorts of things that people can't afford on a McDonald's salary when they're being told to sign up for food stamps.
The advice comes as fast food workers from 100 cities across the nation push for $15 an hour pay. The tipping guide from etiquette maven Emily Post on McDonald's websites lists several high ticket suggestions for givers during the holiday seasons, including a gift from your family or 1 week's pay, plus a small gift from your child for an au pair, one day's pay for a housekeeper, and cost of one cleaning for a pool cleaner. Site also lists in suggestions such as dog walkers, massage therapists, and personal fitness trainers.
If you're working at McDonald's, you probably don't have any of those because they're not paying you enough to have any of those.
If you work in a McDonald's, the idea of someone to walk your dog for you probably seems like a fantasy dream.
Yeah.
Like a thing that could not possibly be real, that you long for day and night. But no, it is a real thing. If I pay someone, they will come and clean my house for me.
One of the girls I work with and I were talking about this today. Like, we work with, our customers are largely very wealthy people, and they, like, the money they drop without a thought. And I just, like, you can't help but want to ask them sometimes, like, so what's it like being that rich? Like, is that as awesome as I think it would be? Like, because I am a month behind on my electric bill. So, like, just tell me how that feels to be able to, like, oh, you know what? I like this color lipstick. I'm going to buy four. It's $30 lipstick. But just in case, this way I can keep one in my purse, one at home, one in my summer home. You know, so I always have my favorite lipstick.
In total,
oh gosh, I really like this $60 candle. Give me five of them. I want one for every room in the house.
In total, the tips add up to hundreds, if not more than $1,000 of gift suggestions for McDonald's workers, many of whom earn just above minimum wage. To be fair, though, the restaurant chain does advise employees what you give, if anything at all, should be dictated by your relationship with the service person, how often you utilize the services, and most importantly, your budget. You know, someone in the channel said it, this is some serious let them eat cake shit. This really is. I mean,
that's beyond tone deaf and almost just into being contempt.
Because, I mean, at that point, you are asking for an uprising.
Yeah.
You are asking for them to figure out how to assemble a guillotine out of shit they found in the fryer.
Or just stick your head in the fryer.
That's a faster. Yeah, you know, maybe you shouldn't give them ideas.
It was on Supernatural.
Okay.
It happened in a bigger sense.
That is just, what's an au pair? Even the people in the channel don't even know what the fuck an au pair is.
Au pair is a fancy word for nanny.
Yeah.
That's what rich people call their nannies.
Yeah.
Well, rich people call their nannies nannies. Conspicuously rich people call their nannies au pairs.
Yeah.
Normal people call them babysitters.
You know, earlier you were talking about the common sense shit and just the we're scared of everything. Oh, you're going to be so pissed off. I can already tell you this story.
So pissed off.
Okay, you know, after Newtown, we've had a big debate that lasted all of 5 seconds in this country about weapons and you know, bringing them into schools. And we've had issues with it. And obviously schools are concerned about people bringing firearms.
You know, I actually know people who think the whole Newtown thing was a hoax made up by the Obama administration so they could take our guns.
What if I don't have any?
That obviously worked out, because clearly nobody has guns anymore.
Well, I don't. Oh, my God, it worked! Wait, I never did. Maybe they went back in time.
Yeah, they think the kids were all actors, and, like, none of it ever happened.
They went back in time and took my guns before I was born.
That Obama guy, he's fucking good.
Well, it's led to a lot of stuff like zero tolerance policies, but this, I think, is a zero intelligence policy. 10-year-old suspended for shooting imaginary arrow. Threatened with expulsion under weapons policy. Fawn Grove, Pennsylvania. Incident took place the week of October 14th when fifth grader Johnny Jones asked his teacher for a pencil during class. Jones walked the front of the class to retrieve the pencil, and during his walk back to his seat, his classmate, a friend of Johnny's, held his folder like an imaginary gun and shot at Johnny. Johnny playfully used his hands to draw a bowstring back on a completely imaginary bow and shot an arrow back. Seeing this, another girl in the class reported to the teacher the boys were shooting at each other. The teacher took Johnny and the other boy into the hall and lectured them about their disruption. The teacher then contacted Johnny's mother, Beverly Jones, alerting her to the seriousness of the violation because the children were using firearms in their horseplay.
Yeah, they're little boys.
Before we heard the matter had been referred to the principal, Principal John Horton contacted Mrs. Jones soon thereafter to inform her that Johnny's behavior was a serious offense and would result in expulsion under the school's weapon policy. Because apparently they're scared he could have shot them with his mind.
Is he River Tam? Is he fucking Neo?
Right now I am threatening all of your lives.
Is he Magneto? Is he going to make projectiles out of the fucking paperclips? If he's not one of those three, you're probably overreacting.
Count zero. Tetsuo! Canada! Tetsuo! Yeah, exactly.
This is something little boys do. They run around and go, pew, 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 pew. Yeah. Fall down, I got you, you're dead.
Till the age of 10, if it looks remotely like a gun and or sword, it is used as a gun and or sword.
Yes.
After the age of 10, it's a dick, but that's something else entirely. But for God's sake, I've had a lot of people do things that exactly aren't cool and do feel threatening. This has never felt threatening to me.
But look, like, this is how scared we are. There was, I forget which college in Connecticut, about a month ago, was on lockdown. The whole campus was on lockdown because somebody was spotted on campus carrying a gun. And it turned out to be someone returning from a Halloween party where he was dressed like a soldier and had a fake gun. But granted, he had a gun strapped to him. But, like, this is how scared we are as a culture that anything that even involved, like, the brawl at my local mall got 10 times worse because somebody yelled the word gun. Nobody saw a gun. No gun went off. But somebody yelled the word gun and they were evacuating. Like,
nah.
This is how fucking paralyzed we are by all this shit that keeps going on. And what's frightening is, as paralyzed with fear as we are, nothing's getting done about it. Mental health situation is not improving. Gun control is not improving. So, like, we're doing all this shit that doesn't really help us, and we're terrified.
But you do know what this means?
Nothing effective is happening.
These
people who need help aren't getting help. The people who shouldn't have guns still have access to guns.
There is an upside to this. It means that I could go and take over the town of Fawn Grove, Pennsylvania with my finger. I'm in charge now!
Well, there's that movie where Charlie Sheen robs a store with a Butterfinger.
That was a bad movie, though. I remember that movie.
Most Charlie Sheen movies are bad.
Our last story this week, I understand there are different cultures. And different cultures have different references and stuff. Especially in regards to the holidays. And I don't usually mock that. But however, there is an old saying that tradition exists because we just couldn't think of anything else better to do. And I really wish they could have thought of something better than this. This comes to us from Holland. I didn't know this was a thing. This is a thing. This is a bad thing. Holland's annual blackface Christmas tradition.
Oh, yeah, Sambo Pete. You didn't know about the Sambo Pete thing?
I do now. December 5th, the day Dutch children get to open their presents from Sinterklaas, the original Santa from which the American Santa Claus is derived. In Holland, they do Christmas a little differently. First, he isn't from the North Pole. He lives in Spain, where every year he sails in a boat, not a flying sled, from Spain to Holland, where he mounts a white horse and roams the country until December 5th, when, if children have been good, he fills their shoes with candy. Like in America, there's a naughty list for kids, but unlike what happens in America if children have been bad, Santa Claus kicks them and beats them with a switch and stuffs them in his sack and takes them back to Spain. And that's
because there's no worse fate than going to Spain.
That's okay. Enough. That's bad enough. But if it sounds like they're bringing the country's bad children to Spain, sounds a lot of work. It is, which is why Santa Claus has helpers. Unlike America's Santa's elves, Dutch Santa's helpers are a crew of, quote, 6 to 8 black men. The black men are all named Black Pete or Zwarte Piet in Dutch. Sounds like Santa has a bunch of slaves who are not crazy. Zwarte Piet was traditionally recognized as a former until the mid-50s, when cultural awkwardness around Santa being a slave owner changed the official record to being Santa's friends. And this now is a thing they do in Holland every year, is dress in blackface and go around as Santa Claus's slaves.
I mean, it's a pretty old tradition.
And that's why it's just because you do things, if you just keep doing the same thing over and over, that doesn't make it any less stupid. Just because you've done it forever.
I think part of it is the rest of the world doesn't have the same racism triggers that Americans do. So
look at the second picture.
Like, I don't know.
Look at this. Go down to the second picture.
No, I know. I'm looking at them. Like, but
Harrow Zeppelin said,
there's a Brendan Gleeson movie called The Guard, where Don Cheadle plays an American FBI agent over there investigating a case. And Brendan Gleeson says something terribly racist, and John Cheadle is outraged by it. And he's like, well, I'm Irish. Like, it's a joke among Irish people, the casual racism of the Irish, you know? And
Harrow Zeppelin, like, I see a white man and I want to paint it black.
But, you know, Americans have a lot of specific racist triggers that the rest of the world kind of doesn't have or hasn't had up until recently. So, you know.
Maybe it's time to retire this one, huh?
I'm not saying it's not a little weird, you know, to do the black thing with the big red lips and the whole nine.
Because essentially they have this tradition where if you're bad, Santa Claus and 8 black men will break into your home, beat you up, and take you to Spain.
And I mean, I'm not defending it. I'm not saying that makes it okay. I'm not trying to say that. Like,
as if that's...
I'm not in a position to say anything like that, obviously. I'm, you know, a little white girl. But,
You're going to scare children. Children are going to see black men and go, oh my God, Santa's coming, and run like hell.
Well, I mean, that's... And it's not just Holland, I don't think, because I think this is the story in a few different countries in Europe.
Oh, my God. You know,
because you have the dolls. You have, like, the Zwarte Piet dolls. And those, really. Those look like... I forget what we call the dolls here now. But they were, you know, the very, very racist dolls that... And that's what the Zwarte Piet dolls look like.
I don't know. That's...
The Goslog dolls, thank you.
Yeah, those. Oh, in England. Yeah, they finally started kind of saying, you know, this was a bad idea.
Yeah. But the Zwarte Piet dolls often kind of look like those.
I think it'd be time for Zwarte Piet and the Goslog to just go off into the sunset.
Yes. Like I said, I'm not trying to defend it. I'm just saying, like, the views in a lot of foreign countries are different on this stuff. Like, we're a lot more sensitive to it.
Emily Dash, watch out for roving gangs of Al Jolsons.
That wouldn't be so bad. You would just sing and dance. Be kind of like you know, running into a barbershop quartet. Boys to men.
I guess that's the first thing we've learned tonight. Yes, it's tradition. Yes, you've done it forever. That doesn't mean it's not a bad thing to be doing forever.
I mean, you could argue slavery was tradition.
Yeah.
We don't. We stopped.
Bullfighting's a tradition.
That should stop.
Running of the bulls. That's another one. Hey, let's. It's traditional to go and nearly get trampled to death by a bunch of very angry large bovines. Not a good tradition. We learned that we have lost our collective minds in this country because we now do. Okay, I don't understand. If
we are crippled with fear and expressing that fear in entirely ineffective ways.
Do tinfoil hats stop imaginary arrows?
Probably.
Okay, so Reynolds, you have a new niche market now. Imaginary arrow protection.
Protection from little baby Katniss Everdeens. And there it is.
We've learned that the people at McDonald's who work at McDonald's at CEOs, they do not fucking get it.
Fucking horrible people. Jesus. Like, are you, was your goal for this year to try and make the Walmart people look sensitive?
The Walmart.
I mean, if that was your corporate goal, like if your mission statement for this year was, let's make the Walmart people look like good people to work for. Good job.
The Waltons are going, thank God for McDonald's, huh?
You've really created a new low. But I don't think that's a great goal.
No. We learned that we really don't want to hear from our tits.
No.
They can pretty much keep their opinions to themselves.
Yes. And bras are annoying enough. And obviously that was a product designed by men. Because no woman would ever design a bra that nags you.
I know. You know, maybe I could understand like an armband or something or, you know, like even a shirt. Even a shirt.
My bra already annoys me several times during the course of a day. I don't need it fucking nagging me. I don't need it judging my life choices. Absolutely not. I know I'm fat. I've accepted it. It's fine.
Could you?
I'm going to have that slice of pizza anyway. Fuck you.
Could you get into a texting argument with your tits via this bra? Is that possible? We learned that the TSA, again, over fucking reacting. We learned driving a tank is not as easy as it looks. Seriously. I guess he must have thought, well, that's a clutch. That's a transmission. Pfft, what could go wrong?
I suppose, really, the idea is, read the fucking manual is not always enough.
No.
Like, yes, read the fucking manual, but that's only the start.
Knowing is half the battle. The other half is not getting in the fucking tank!
Not trying to drive it across the highway.
The second time is the beautiful one. It's like, no way, my bad, I got this, yo.
Yeah.
I need a do-over. I call do-over. Do-over. It's cool now. And lastly, we learned if you are going to go and attempt to extort food with bladed implements,
Go
for the gold, not tacos. Don't go for the tacos. Unless you really like tacos, but then just six. I would like, give me 50. 50 fucking tacos I could see, baby.
Like, I never used to understand when I worked at Sephora that people would steal the testers.
Computer Ronan just said, sell the sword for taco money.
Like, if you're going to steal the live product. Don't steal the half-empty thing that everybody in town has touched. If you're going to steal,
Yeah,
make it worth it. If you're going to commit a crime, make it fucking worth it.
You sound like you've put some thought into this.
Well, my crimes are always worth it. On the off chance that I ever get caught, which I never will, it'll totally be worth it.
I'm not going to have to testify against you in court, am I?
No, because I'm never going to get caught.